No. Let me please introduce Professor Amnon Krugman. He will present his research together with Gennady Makrinich about the force exerted by a fireball. Yeah, correct?
Correct.
My talk is on a specific phenomenon, the force exerted by a fireball. Here is a picture. There is no really fire, it's just a name. A fireball like that we see in our experiment is seen in several other experiments in the last several years, and also in this conference there is a fireball in atmospheric pressure that Dikhtiar and Eli Gerby will describe this afternoon, and I look forward to see the similarity, if there is. Let me show how it really how it looks. So this is the fireball. This is the trailer. The full movie you'll see soon in your local theater. But meanwhile, we'll discuss it. So, as you saw very vividly, this fireball exerts force on a pendulum, and sometimes it is stable and the pendulum just deviates, and sometimes it oscillates, it kicks it, and as you saw. And what we try to understand is what is the source and what causes the force that exerted on the fireball. And as I will show, we found that the force per ion exiting the fireball, we calculate the force, we calculate how many ions hit the pendulum, and we calculate what is the force per ion, or the impulse. And we find that this force is larger than the maximal force that an ion can exert according to the potential drop that the ion causes. So what we wonder is, what are the possible mechanisms for the enhancement of this force? And we examined two possibilities. One of them is that the force is enhanced by ion-neutral collisions during the ion acceleration. This is one mechanism. And the other is that it's actually not, the force is not by ions, but through neutral gas heating by the electron current. Yeah. In both cases, of course, the source of the energy for the pushing is the electrical energy. In one case, it is the electrical energy that the ions acquire, and in the other case, it's the electron energy that is deposited by the electrons. So this is how the experimental system looks. We call it a radial plasma source, but the fact that it is radial is irrelevant in this case, because what we have is, as you see, an anode where it is positive, and there is a cathode which is negative. And the main idea is that a plasma ball is generated when you apply a DC voltage. So in this picture, the plasma ball is generated in this region, and the force is exerted on the pendulum. So the pendulum and the ruler allow us to measure the force, and the probe, here is a Langmuir probe, that allow us to measure the ion flux. And these are the two main things that we measure. Just to see the sizes, the diameter of this is about 8 centimeters. That gives you an idea of what is the physical dimensions of this device. We use this especially with a magnetic field, and the magnetic field is our main driver, the magnetic pressure, for pushing the ions, but not in this experiment. In this experiment, the magnetic field is zero. there is no role to any magnetic field. In the afternoon, Gennady Makrinich, my colleague, will describe experiments on this device with the magnetic field, but this not in this talk. So here is the picture, the same, the schematic of the experiment, and the picture with the same size. Here you see the plasma ball and the pendulum. Here is the plasma ball, should be here, and the pendulum. The parameters, we keep usually the current is 1.4 ampere. The voltage that develops is about 50 volts, about 30 volts on the plasma ball and 20 volts in the cathode sheet. The gas we use is argon. The anode gas fluorate that comes from the center of the source is 35 SCCM. And the pressure is 5 millitors far away from the source, but inside the source, the pressure is probably several times larger, and there is no magnetic field. Okay, so as I said, what we measure are two things. First, the force by the balance force meter, as I'll explain briefly, and the ion current that we collect by a Langham report. How do we measure the force? One case is you didn't see in the movie because there were oscillations, but we measure the deviation of the pendulum, and from the deviation we can calculate, estimate what is the force. The other thing is we measured the period of oscillations. As you see here, we measured the period, the oscillations, and we measured the period when we saw how the period of oscillation deviates from the usual period of the pendulum. And since if the force is not constant, of course, that won't change the period, but the force depends on the distance, then we derived some nonlinear equation for the pendulum, but we calculate from the measured force what is the, from the measured deviation of the period, what is the force. So from these two, we got about the same result for the force. So we conclude that the force on the pendulum is 46 micronewton. The Langmuir probe collects ion current, the ion saturation current, which is 1.7 milliampere. And when we normalize to the slight difference in distance, we find that the force per ion, the impulse per ion, is, as we see, you see here, the number here. Now we calculate what if each ion that comes acquires the maximal velocity that it can acquire from the potential drop. And we find what is the impulse, the maximal impulse per ion. And we find that the measured impulse is more than 6 times larger than the maximal impulse that an ion can exert. And as I said, this is what we try to explain. So the two sources, as I said, is ion neutral collisions during ion acceleration. And if these are ion neutral collisions, the source is actually the plasma pressure. The pressure of the plasma is the source of the force. The other possibility is that electron hits the gas pressure increases, and this is the source of the force. And in this case, the source of the force is not the plasma pressure, but rather the increased gas pressure. So this is the picture. Assume we have a plasma ball and ions coming in all directions, and they exert the force. They are the source of the force, but actually if they collide with neutrals, they transfer some of their momentum to the neutrals, and the force is the combination of the ion-neutral force, where the source of the energy of the momentum is what was acquired by the ions. So I think we mentioned this phenomena several times also in these meetings, but I'll repeat it, I'll say it again. How do collisions add to the momentum? You would think that collisions only redistribute the momentum between particles. Ions get momentum, they give some of it to the neutrals. So this is not the case. This is the case if neutrals collide after they've been accelerated. However, if ions collide during the acceleration, the net momentum that the flow acquires is larger. The electric energy that is delivered to the ions is only determined by the ion current and the potential drop. However, the momentum depends on the length of time that an ion spins. The impulse is force multiplied by time. So the electric energy is deposited in a larger mass, because it's not only in the ions, also by the neutrals, and therefore the ions and neutrals get the same kinetic energy, but a larger momentum. So this is what we examined, and we know that this works in the case of magnetic field, and actually we try even to build a thruster based on this. However, in this case, we examined what is this mechanism in this experiment. The increase of momentum is proportional to the square root of this number, where sigma is the ion-neutral cross-section collisions, n is the density of the neutrals, and a is the length, is the radius of the plasma fireball, which is 1.7 centimeters now, okay? And this is an increased pressure. Actually, it's the square root of the number of mean free paths for ion-neutral collisions during the acceleration. And if we have a model, I give only the final results, this is what should be the impulse. It is increased by this factor, by the ion mass and the ion acoustic velocity. And then we can calculate what should be the neutral density in order to explain this increased thrust. The neutral density tends to be this number. It's about 5×10²² per meter cubed, and it is about 55 times larger than what our estimated neutral density. So we conclude that the density in our experiment is too low for this mechanism to explain the enhanced force. So the other explanation is that electro-neutral collisions increase the neutral temperature, then as the neutral pressure, and this increased pressure is what happens. So here is the description. Let's say that gas coming from all directions into the fireball get heated by the electron current, the pressure goes up and the force is increased. So this is a cartoon of what we expect may be happen. Now, how can it happen? In other experiments done by Stenzel and others, it's a pulse fireball. If you hit by a pulse a local place of the gas, the temperature goes up, the pressure goes up, and then a force is exerted by the flow that goes outside of the fireball. Then the density goes down until a pressure balance is established, and then there is no force anymore. So a force really is felt as long as there is a particle flux outside of the fireball. Our experiment is a steady fireball. How can we have a force if it's a steady? You would expect just a pressure balance to be established. You do not exert force by a heater in your room. Yes, but in our case, what we examine is maybe that we actually have a flux of particles that's coming that we push all the time. And let's see what these flux of particles into and outside of the fireball, what kind of force it can exert. It's easy to find that the force is actually the square root of the flux of particle multiplied by the power of the heating power. This should be the force. This is, and then, therefore, we can calculate what is the heating rate by electron-neutral collisions. It's proportional to the product of the densities of neutrals and plasma, and, of course, the collision rate by the cross-section of collisions, the electron energy, and you know that electron-neutral collision is very inefficient. It goes down by the mass ratio of electron to ions, and then we calculate what is the particle flux. Actually, from this balance, we can find, in order to, from our measurements of force and particles, we can calculate what is the neutral density and the power and the neutral flux out of the fireball. So we find that the neutral density is actually very reasonable. The power is very also very reasonable. Actually, a very small power of milliwatts can give you enough for the force. However, the flux of neutrals that is necessary for this mechanism to be valid is given here. It's about 5, 10 to the 19th particles per second. It is actually larger than all the flow rate in our experiment. So if the source of the particles that go into the fireball and outside of the fireball is what we feed into the system, there is no enough flux. So the only mechanism maybe is that maybe the heating of the gas induces flow into the fireball area from all sides, a large flow, and this could explain the force. But I cannot say that this, I would think that this is necessarily realistic. So I can conclude that we examined mechanisms that could result in a large momentum delivered to the flow outward of a fireball. Enhanced momentum by ion-neutral collisions, the necessary neutral gas density in our experiment seems too high for what we have in our experiment. On the other hand, the other mechanisms we suggest, which is enhanced force due to increased gas pressure, the necessary neutral gas flow seems too high. So at the moment, we do not have a clear explanation for this force. Thank you.
Thank you very much for this very interesting talk. Questions?
It is a good idea, but just because of technical reasons, we didn't further explore it. But we will consider this. Yeah.
If you had an unlimited budget, is there a diagnostic that you could run that differentiates the
Yeah, but first you could do more measurements, of course. You could try to see what is the flux of neutrals, what is the flow, the exact flow. We could make various measurements. But I think that what Isik suggested is even simpler. Even in our budget, we don't have an unlimited time, but it's just to measure change parameters in what we have, and this could shed light, maybe, hopefully, on this experiment, yeah. So,
do you have measured the potential of this fireball? Can you exclude that this is not clone interaction with your pendulum?
No, I cannot exclude, but I do not understand what kind of Coulomb interaction. The way that I thought about Coulomb... the way I thought about any charging, it always worked in the other direction, that it shouldn't push. That was my impression, but I wouldn't exclude thinking about it further. Yeah, especially that the two mechanisms that we did suggest did not work out. But measurements of potential we didn't do, they are very good, especially that the basic model of all this fireball is that there is a double layer, and all the physics that we did, the double layer does not seem really relevant. So there is a lot to do. We did measurements, Gennady did a lot, many measurements of potentials, but not in this experiment, in other experiments. Yeah. But it is isolated. It's isolated. Yeah, I understand. No, I don't think... what was the material, Gennady?
Okay, thank you. Okay, let's continue and after that this discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.